humanity. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, really is at the core of this project. And one of the reasons why I wanted to do it.
You said you started in Africa, and then where did you mm-hmm. go from there?
So we spent actually quite a bit of time in Africa. We were in Tanzania, Uganda, and Ethiopia, and then continued out through the Middle East to Oman and Turkey, Georgia, Mongolia, and the Alaska and the Pacific Northwest.
Really?
I think I've covered them all.
A lot of ancient, what we consider perhaps ancient lands. And was mm-hmm. that your first time visiting many of those places? And what was that experience like for you?
Many of them for sure. And it was absolutely mind-blowing because it wasn't like, you know, we were traveling as tourists. We were really embedding ourselves in these environments. So if we ever ran into any people while we were scouting or whatever, they were people that were living off the land and practicing sort of these historic traditional food acquisition methods and things like that. So we were able to really learn from them as we went. And it was unique because we weren't sort of, I guess, buffered from nature in many ways. Like I was exposed to contaminated water and to any of those same like parasitic elements that anyone who lived in these environments would have been. And it was a really beautiful experience to, I guess, not have that buffer, to not be on, you know, a tour bus or to not be sort of protected and estranged from the environments that I was in. I think a lot of the time when many people travel, they want these exotic experiences without taking on some of the threats or risks or fears they might have. But one thing that I found time and time again, it was, you know, and I have to also say that Bill and I were pretty remote. We generally weren't around a lot of people, but when we were traveling, when we were scouting, anytime we met people that were local to the area, time and time again, regardless of our differences in politics and religion or even language barriers, what was greater than the differences was the desire to connect. And that was so eye-opening for me. Wherever we went, from Africa to Mongolia, people just wanted to connect.
It sounds so transformative for you, Kat. I mean, I can hear it in your tone, and I'm so happy that you had a chance to experience that and can now be an ambassador for humanity through the show and mm-hmm. really through your own personal daily life.
You're listening to World Footprints Radio with Ian and Tanya Fitzpatrick, and we're exploring whether science and archaeology can uncover humankind's ancestral journey with Kat Bigney, co-host of National Geographic's The Great Human Race.
So I can see where your training as an outdoor survival certified person came in handy, but what about your education? You have a degree in anthropology and earth sciences. Were you able to apply that knowledge mm-hmm. to what you did on the show?
In some ways, I mean, I think that there's sort of a language that you learn to speak, and there are some things you learn about appropriateness, you know, in academia, and that was valuable. And there were different things that I learned that I'd read, but nothing can prepare you for the raw impact. I think it's one thing to read about something and to theorize. It's another thing entirely to experience it. What actually prepared me for this more than anything was probably that I grew up with an atypical background, and I didn't learn survival skills from a book or from, you know, classes. I acquired them along the way. And so having the ability to embed myself in any environment and just problem solve without thinking about right or wrong and how I was supposed to handle the situation was beneficial. And I don't want to downplay having a degree. I think it's a good thing. I think it's helpful to understand certain aspects of anthropology, archaeology, and you know, the environments that Bill and I were in. But I think that we are all hardwired to survive. And our ability to creatively problem solve and come up with solutions, whether it's in the form of turning raw materials into metal, which we did somewhere along the way, or to innovate and create a sharp knife out of a rock, or to, you know, be building ships or spaceships that we are now. These are all a product of who we are and our DNA. It's something that I think we have encoded in us. And along those lines, you should never underestimate anyone. So I'm learning like these things from people we're meeting along the way, and my mind is blown. It doesn't matter how much education I have or what degree I have. Like there's so much that I don't know and will never know.
Sure.
And I am grateful that I've had the opportunity to learn so many people across the globe. And yes, a formal education is important, but there's education beyond that. There's education at a human level.
It makes pure sense with your background in outdoor survival training. But I didn't know if your educational background came into play when being considered for this show.
When talking to National Geographic Studios about this project since like September of 2014, so for a long time. It's no coincidence that Bill Schindler was cast as the co-host because he specifically is able to reproduce stone tools that are museum quality, that represent a time period. And it isn't just that I have a survival skill set, I also have that in accompanying with a degree in anthropology and prehistory in my research and earth sciences. So these things were taken into consideration. This was a very difficult project, and you know, it wasn't ever like I just showed up on location and did my thing. I've been working nonstop for a year doing research and consulting and really embedding myself not only in every location but also in the process. And it was essential. This was like an impossible project. We have two people trying to recreate these scenarios in history and gain an understanding of what it would have been like to have been some of our earliest ancestors, but the environment's different. Even though we're doing research in paleobotany, there's no way we can recreate the environment, and we're just two people. We're representing the social infrastructure that existed, you know, 2 million years ago. And so there are so many limitations, but there's also a lot that we can do. So having a background for Bill and for myself was really important in terms of maybe even things that will never show up on television, but things that we were able to do that we understood so that we could move forward.
Now, how has this journey really impacted your personal life?
There are so many layers, really. So first of all, like on an academic level, like of course there are things that I learned along the way. I learned things about archaeology, about our species, and about humanity, and those are very meaningful for me. And the insight that it gave me to the human spirit, being able to have access to so many different people across the globe in such a short time, changed my perspective forever and really made me understand what it means to be a global community member, to be an advocate for humanity, really, and for the entire human race. And to understand that, you know, regardless of these differences, there's just the differences that we turn into wars are so small compared to the very basic needs of human, and how great it is to see just someone who has such a different background than you to have total compassion on you. For example, I was in Mongolia for a while, and it was between episodes, and I damaged some of my clothing, and my hands were so just mangled and destroyed from some of the work that we'd been doing, and they just didn't work properly, and I had to repair some clothing before we started working again. And this beautiful, beautiful Mongolian woman that lived in a gary yurt was this amazing seamstress and tailor, and she offered up her time to help me, and she didn't care who I was or where I came from or where I lived or how I lived. She assumed I was actually an actress, which is pretty funny, but she volunteered her time because she just saw that I needed help. And we didn't speak the same language at all, but still communicated, and we were laughing, and it was just one of the most beautiful, pure moments I think I've ever had in my life.
Oh, that's lovely.
And it just, and I've had so many this last year. It's humbling. It is so humbling. It's made me care about global problems in ways that I didn't think that I would, to feel them, to understand, you know, when I hear stories about, you know, Syrian refugees and the struggles they've had, you know, like I've been in areas where they've probably been, and to feel like they're, you know, like I'm part of that group and that community. And not just that I want to do something because I want to be a philanthropist and a good person, but because there's a part of me and a part of my heart that's connected to them. It's a strange thing.
Well, Kat, thank you very much for spending time with me on World Footprints and sharing your story.
Oh, thank you. It was my pleasure.
To watch episodes of The Great Human Race, visit the National Geographic website for showtime listings, or see this show page at worldfootprints.com for a direct link. Travel really is a gift. We've heard that from Phil. We heard it from Kat. We heard it certainly from Robert. And the one common denominator for all of them and us is the passion that we share for travel, the passion that we have for other people and for learning about other cultures and communities and just really giving back. And certainly the focus on voluntourism, which The Amazing Race embarks upon and some of their shows, sustainability, which ties in very well with Dominica and their commitment to maintaining the natural treasures that the island has.
And Dominica really is a testament to sustainability and to really having something that's unique in the Caribbean. The island is not really that developed compared to its neighbors, and they've really made an effort to try to maintain this pristineness about the place, and that's intriguing. And I also found intriguing, too, were kind of the cultural links between Dominica and places such as New Orleans, where we've spent a lot of time because of the common Creole culture, which is a big part of their food culture in Dominica.
One of the things that also intrigued me about the interviews that we shared today, Robert Rose's focus on voluntourism, on sharing communities, on connecting communities, and Kat Bigney's enthusiasm for what we do and how it reflects her passion, her interest in what they're trying to do with her show, The Great Human Race. And of course, you know, Phil's near-fatal scuba diving accident, which transformed his thinking, his way of life, and inspired commitment to giving back and philanthropy and his appreciation for life and how that's reflected in what he does on The Amazing Race. And the funny thing, you know, when I was talking to Phil, I kept wanting to ask him, okay, give us some tips. How can you and I get on The Amazing Race? Because as you know, honey, I've been taking copious notes over the years watching The Amazing Race, and we figured out what you would do. You would be the map reader, I'd be the driver, and I would do all the food challenges because you're a little bit picky.
Yeah, I am picky. I'm not interested in eating bugs or any of that kind of stuff, but it would be interesting to see how we would do with the stresses and strains of The Amazing Race. And I want to come back to Robert and Kat because they really speak to this notion of a common humanity. Right. And in the exploration of what they do through their respective shows, this really came out, and it was nice to feel that there are a few more people on this island of socially conscious travelers and that you're not out here in the wilderness, and to hear it from other people was truly refreshing.
Yeah, and when we talked to Robert and Kat, and when I actually met Robert in New York, you know, there's some people that we meet on this journey that we're on that we really connect with. And, you know, for me, of course, Maya Angelou was one person, but I really connected with Rob and Kat. And I looked at one of the episodes that Kat is in The Great Human Race, and they really are kind of bare bones. You know, they're going through this discovery using bare bone methods. And she talked about how much her hands were torn up and how affected she had been from different viruses or bacteria or what have you. And I looked at her photo and I thought, oh my gosh, she is such a beautiful woman. I could not imagine her, you know, roughing it as much as she does on that show. Thank you guys again for joining us. In closing, we'd like for you to consider this thought. We travel not to escape life, but for life not to escape us. As always, we have really enjoyed spending this time with you, and we thank you for inviting us into your life. We're Tanya and Ian Fitzpatrick, and we look forward to sharing another amazing journey with you on World Footprints Radio.
World Footprints Radio with Ian and Tanya Fitzpatrick is a production of World Footprints Media, Silver Spring, Maryland. The multi-award-winning radio show can be heard around the globe on iHeartRadio, Stitcher, iTunes, and more. Visit worldfootprints.com for a complete list. World Footprints Radio is a leading voice in socially responsible travel. At worldfootprints.com, you'll find an archive of past broadcasts, travel news, reviews, and information you can use to deepen your travel experience. Listen, learn, and live it at worldfootprints.com.